Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. This is a great opportunity for us all as the NHL family to get together and celebrate a truly unique and special NHL All Star Weekend. To have the 2017 Honda NHL All Star Weekend here in Los Angeles is turning out to be spectacular. With our centennial underway, as you all know, last night we announced the 100 greatest players, at least those from the last 50 years, in the history of the NHL. And not coincidentally, I suppose, we're celebrating 50 years of NHL hockey in Los Angeles. So where better to be than LA Live and the Staples Center and all of the convenience, amenities, and excitement that this is providing for us. It's a great spotlight for our activities. It's a great spotlight for our players, our game, our history. And while I'm sure the fans here in California are enjoying it, all the feedback I'm getting from all the guests who have come in from out of town has been nothing short of sensational. So I want to thank Phil Anschutz, David Beckerman, and Luke Robitaille for all of their efforts on our behalf, turning this very complicated and undertaking into a reality. I want to recognize and thank the Kings for using this all-star opportunity to also conduct a variety of other events throughout the community. They make it a point, as do all of our teams, to give back to the communities that they play in. So this week, for example, the Kings helped to build an edible and interactive garden for students at an elementary school. The Kings orchestrated cleanup days at area beaches. They participated in a Habitat for Humanity home build. And in conjunction with the league, we were proud to work with the Kings in our legacy effort at the Crenshaw Family YMCA, where we rededicated that facility after the renovation that it went through our joint efforts. We think that anything that we can do as a league, and I know our teams and our players believe it, to give back to the community and make a difference in people's lives is part of the responsibility that we have based on the visibility and role that we have. And all of this focus on legacy and what we can leave behind in making a difference comes barely a week before the commencement of Hockey is for Everyone Month. We were also proud yesterday, speaking of hockey being for everyone, to conduct a Women in Sports Business panel, which Catherine Tappan from NBC hosted for us. And it was a very well attended and very well received panel. Helene Elliott of the LA Times was on it, Alyssa Milano, Ducks co-owner Susan Samueli, and Angela Ruggiero were on the panel, as well as the NHL's new chief marketing officer, Heidi Browning. So I thank them, and again, it was very well received and very well attended. In support of our Learn to Play initiative, which we run in conjunction with the Players Association, we were also pleased to conduct the clinic here at Staples Center for young people. We also conducted the Future Goals activity that was led by our ambassador for diversity programs, Willie O'Ree. And at our Fanfare Kids Day, Willie worked with over 2,000 students to get them acquainted with the Future Goals curriculum. One additional community note, today's 2017 All-Star Celebrity Shootout will benefit Echoes of Hope, a non-profit organization founded by Luke and Stasia Robitaille, which strives to inspire hope in the lives of at-risk and emancipated foster youth. And that's an organization that does great work in pursuit of empowerment and post-secondary education. Individually and collectively, these activities reflect the power and the ability of sports as I mentioned before, to not only entertain but to do good deeds in the communities. And when we have our events throughout North America, we like to leave something behind. This is a value that's extremely important to the entire NHL family. From a hockey standpoint, this is the third All-Star game the Kings have hosted. And since they are the tenured member of the NHL's California community, it's important to acknowledge the role that the Kings have had, as well as the Ducks and the Sharks, in the growth of hockey in this state. In 1981, when the game was played at the Forum in Inglewood, the number of registered hockey players was about 3,400 in California. In 2002, when the Kings hosted the All-Star game here at Staples, the registered players was about 17,000. And as we return here in 2017, the latest registered count for players in California stands at over 28,000. Only six states have more registered players, and we have no doubt that the Kings, the Ducks, and the Sharks have played an important role in building grassroots hockey throughout the state. We've all obviously recognized the role of Wayne Gretzky, our centennial ambassador. He was vital, I think, to that growth, and I guess you've probably all heard, as an aside, that he'll be coaching tonight and tomorrow. And in addition to wishing him a belated happy birthday, it was this past Thursday, we were thrilled to be able to round out the list of the 100 greatest players in the NHL's history. Last night, if you were there, if you watched it on television, was nothing short of spectacular. It was truly a historic event, not just for the 100 players or their families, but sitting there as a fan watching it, this is the type of event that is truly unique, truly special. It's a once in a lifetime. And I got to tell you, it was an honor to be there. It was nothing short of emotional, compelling, exciting, and it once again made me grateful to be associated with this great game. Before I take your questions, let me give you a brief catch-up on today's board meeting. We had a variety of updates, and from a business standpoint, we gave an update on Las Vegas, which is doing very well and anxious to begin doing all the things it needs to do as a league member. And so everybody's looking forward to that. We had our medical experts give us an update on the recent International Concussion Conference that took place, I think, the end of October in Berlin. And other than that, and some general reports on our digital media and the like, which we typically do in a business report, to anticipate a question, the issue of the Olympics got about 10 seconds of discussion. It wasn't even on the agenda. I reported that there was nothing new since the board meeting in December, and I asked if anybody had anything to say or had any questions, and there was none, and we moved along. And so we intentionally have a brief board meeting at All-Star because there's obviously a lot of other things going on. So even though it seems like the World Cup was yesterday, I believe there's fewer than 10 weeks remaining in the regular season when the schedule resumes on Tuesday night. We've had a remarkable season to this point, and I have no doubt that the excitement will grow as our playoff races head down the home stretch. And with that, Deputy Commissioner Bill Daly is here with me, and we are both happy to take your questions, and I'm more than happy to defer any questions you ask to him, but let's see how they go.
Down to your left. What do you want the younger players, there's a lot of younger players in this game, what do you want them to take from the NHL 100, the Connor McDavids, the Line A's, the Austin Matthews, and where do you see the game going in the next 10, 20 years?
That's a great question. What was remarkable to me over the last couple of days, and even through this process when I called the 100 players or their families, is this is a sport that prides itself on its history and its tradition and the great players that have played this game. And when you see the love that they have for the game, the respect that they have for the game and each other, the way they all give back, that to me are the values that are so important in our game: hard work, teamwork, respect. And to watch the players interact to each other, you know, a player who's in his 40s was remarking about what a pleasure it was to meet, I don't mean decade, I'm talking about his age, a player in his 60s. It was very rarefied air, but the one common denominator that they all shared, and it was palpable, was a love of this great game. And if you're going to be a player in this league, we want you to love what you're doing.
Gary,
yes.
Can you speak? You said at the board meeting there was a discussion on concussions. Many of your players, starting with Crosby today, spoke about the issue, about how they feel confident they will be taken care of after they're done playing. I'm certain you're confident in that, but can you update anything on that issue and to their feelings that they will be taken care of?
I'm not sure. I didn't hear his comments, so I'm not exactly sure what you're referring to, but player safety is something that is a priority for us, always has been. We spend a great deal of time and effort and money in making sure that the game can be as safe as possible based on the medical knowledge that's available at the time. And I believe that our players get the best treatment that can be given.
Gary, I asked Peter Karmanos after the board meeting today for an update on where the potential sale of his franchise stands, and he said that as time goes on, he's becoming more and more open-minded to the idea of selling it fully. I mean, the idea was that he was going to have a share in it originally. I just wonder where you feel that situation is right now and what that means.
I actually don't think it's any different than what Peter's been telling me over time. He didn't say he's committed to selling it. He just said, as I think you've quoted him, is he's more open-minded. I think at this stage of Peter's life, and he's got lots of things going on and lots of kids and little kids, I think he's focused on what's best in the long term for the franchise in Raleigh-Durham and what's best for him and his family. And so I think he hasn't ruled anything in or anything out, and there's no formal sale process ongoing. I think if anything, you got him in a candid moment expressing open-mindedness, perhaps a little whimsically, but there's nothing that's been decided.
Gary, over here, I appreciate it. Thank you. You mentioned a little bit, yesterday Wayne Gretzky talked about the participation numbers in high school, how they're phenomenal. You mentioned, you know, the more participants here. In particular with the new Las Vegas franchise, how vital is it for Foley and that whole group to kind of to build the grassroots, to build a foundation with youth hockey for that market?
Well, it's vital to build it, and I think most, if not all, of our clubs do a good job on it. If you go just down the five a little bit to Anaheim, I think there used to be two high school hockey teams, and now there are 50 or 60. All of our clubs are committed in a variety of ways to building the game. If you think back to Ed Snyder's legacy in Snyder Hockey, it was about bringing the game to more kids, particularly those in disadvantaged circumstances. And his thrust there wasn't about building hockey fans, it was about using, as I discussed before, using hockey to make a difference in people's lives, to teach the right values growing up to young people. So our clubs do it. I know Bill Foley is committed to doing it as well. And you see it throughout the league, more and more rinks. And, you know, Austin Matthews is another example, grassroots hockey in Arizona. And ultimately, I suppose his interest in the game doesn't take place without the Coyotes. Go ahead. Turn the mic on.
Just a quick follow up on the Vegas situation.
Yes.
If you knew then what you know now with the Raiders trying to squeeze into that market, would it have been a little more difficult?
No.
To...
We're not focused on the Raiders. We'll see if they ever ultimately wind up there. The thing that is true is the Las Vegas Golden Knights. The Vegas Golden Knights are alive and well, going to be there. There's no speculation. It's not contingent. There aren't a whole bunch of other things that have to happen. This team is there for the community and will be there very shortly.
Gary, I understand Dan Craig spoke to the Board of Governors today about ice issues, and we've heard some public concerns about ice quality. Had a game canceled. It wasn't ice quality, but you had system problems.
System broke down.
Carolina. Do you have a – is this troubling to you, or what, how would you characterize the issue of ice quality and how the players play.
I love the way you phrased the question. Is it troubling to me? No, it's not troubling to me. The fact is we pride ourselves on being vigilant and thorough, and Dan's presence before the board was consciousness raising. You know, maybe the same routines, you got to go take a second look. We want to make sure ice conditions are good for a competitive game, and most importantly, we want to make sure that they're safe for the players. Over time, when a player has perhaps a subpar game, you hear, oh, the ice was terrible. Well, it's the same for both teams. We're more concerned with fundamental breakdowns, a hole in the ice where the ice went soft, where the system breaks down. You know, when glass breaks, there should be procedures, as there are in all buildings, to get the glass in as quickly as possible. Every now and then, systems tend to break down, and what the point of today's discussion was, let's go look at the systems again. Let's make sure the ice crews are on top of what needs to be done. Let's have our A game. Let's not get complacent, because we generally don't have ice problems. And, you know, maybe it was a full moon. Maybe it was a coincidence. Maybe it was bad luck. But we had a few building issues in a very short period of time. Our goal is to do better and to have our buildings do better.
Gary, from a scheduling standpoint, how long do you think the Olympic issue can sort of hang in the balance?
I don't know the answer to that. It's you know, when it happens, and I suppose the time passes, we'll know about it if nothing's been done. We're not the ones who are setting deadlines.
Yes. To your left. How would you evaluate the chances of I know that you want to organize a special event in Montreal this November for the centennial, but what are the chances of seeing an outdoor game in Montreal in November at this point?
Not prepared to commit or give you odds. We're looking at all options to make sure that as the centennial celebration continues into next season and we get to the latter part of 2017, we're touching the right bases.
Gary, Rene Fasel said today that they've got the money to cover the cost of the NHL players playing in the next Olympics. If that's the case, what's the biggest hurdle?
Biggest hurdle is I think there's concern among the teams about the ongoing disruption to the season, about a compressed schedule, and a whole host of other things you've had us talk about. We've never said, and I've been very clear about, that just raising the money was the only issue. We said from the outset that if they're not going to pay the expenses, we don't even have to think about this. What I think has happened, though, you know, there were probably some owners over time who always thought the Olympics were a good idea. There were some owners who always hated it. And then there were probably a bunch of clubs that really didn't give it much thought until the IOC said, we're not going to pay the expenses. And then I think it caused a number of clubs to say, well, wait a minute. If that's how they value our participation, why are we knocking ourselves out? So whether or not it gets paid, and we haven't been assured that it's being paid, we haven't been told where the money's coming from, and frankly, I have on some level, perhaps it's emotional, a real problem if money that would otherwise go to hockey development is being diverted for this purpose. But I think when the IOC said, you know what, we don't think it's worth it, we're not going to pay, I think that may have opened a whole can of worms.
Gary, we got our first look at the NBA's advertising on jerseys recently, and I was wondering, how closely are you and the Board of Governors monitoring that for the next season, and do you foresee an appetite to get ads on NHL jerseys?
No, we haven't been monitoring it. I mean, we're all in this industry and we see what's going on. It's not an active discussion among NHL clubs. The fact of the matter is we take great pride in our sweaters. We think they're the best in all the sports, and that's not something we're running off to do. I always said we wouldn't be first. Okay. Great, NBA is doing it, and it would take an unusual circumstance, which I would define as a lot of money that I'm having trouble comprehending right now, for us to even be thinking about it. We think what we have is special. We talk about history and tradition and how special hockey jerseys are. We're not looking to put advertising on our sweaters. Now, having said that, you'll say, well, you did it in the World Cup. The fact of the matter is the World Cup jerseys aren't like NHL team jerseys.
Gary, here.
Yeah,
there,
sorry.
There are obviously still some issues into the rink in Brooklyn. How much have you talked to the new owners about that, and how committed do you think they are to staying there?
Well, the owners are committed to the franchise. They're committed to New York and the great fan base that has followed the Islanders. There are some issues about playing in Barclay. It may be fundamental as to the ice system, and that's not something that can be fixed in the short term. I think, as is prudent, Scott Malkin and John Ledecky are reviewing the situation and looking very seriously at what their options are.
Mr. Bettman, over here?
So, yes.
Okay, I'm glad that the All-Star game is here, but what went into the decision as far as you have the other proud franchises like Philadelphia and Pittsburgh and who are also on their 50th? So what went into the decision to make it, give it to L.A. At this point?
Well, that's a great question. If I'm not mistaken, the Penguins and the Flyers are playing an outdoor game in Pittsburgh to celebrate their 50th. There was an alumni game in the last couple of weeks in Philadelphia. We have lots of events, but in total, a limited number that we can put on, and we're trying to appropriately honor all of our franchises for their special events as best as possible. Very competitive bidding, but L.A. made a compelling case. You can feel the buzz here in L.A. The situation, the setup logistically here in L.A. Live is perfect for what we're doing. And I think part of this weekend is a testament to Phil Anschutz's vision for Staples Center and downtown L.A. So, you know, you can't make everybody happy all the time, but we're glad we're here to be celebrating together as an NHL family. Yes.
Gary, the Sabres were a little upset with the replay reviews the other night in Dallas, and they certainly looked pretty inconclusive to me. But in general, where do you think the next frontier is with goal reviews? Down the road, can you see puck sensors or infrared in the nets? I mean, what is the next technological step?
We are. First of all, whenever a ruling goes against the club, they always are unhappy. You know, it's much more clear-cut, typically, on offsides. Goaltender interference, I think, perhaps, as a general matter, clubs are using it too much, part of wishful thinking. It was really intended in a situation where the call was just completely blown. You know, you call goaltender interference and he wasn't even touched. It was that type of thing. But we do have the best replay system in the business. All the other leagues have gone to school on us. The centralization, we were the first to do it. We're in constant communication with the buildings. We have lots and lots of cameras. We spare no expense. Having said that, we are continuing to test technology that we hope is scalable that will enable us to do more. It is even possible, and I'm not saying tomorrow, but we're looking at things that will enable us to know exactly where the puck is and whether or not it crossed the line, so you won't even have to see it. You'll be able to know that it was there because the technology will tell you. That would be aspirational. It's something that we're working on, but it isn't ready for prime time because anything we install better work, and it better work right.
Gary, did you get a chance to see the Ice Guardians documentary?
Yes, I did.
In the documentary...
I'm sorry, I didn't. I was thinking of a different one. I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, yeah, no, okay.
I haven't seen it.
In the documentary, they made the point that the Sidney Crosbys and the Eric Lindroses suffer more concussions than the enforcers in the league. And I wanted to ask you if that opens the debate to get rid of the instigator rule.
No, there's no debate on it. We like the rules the way they are. I haven't seen the documentary, so I don't want to comment on what it said. I'd have to see it first. What? I didn't install the instigator rule. I inherited it, and I don't see any problem with the way it's worked. We're not looking to encourage more fighting.
Gary,
the news was out for Mr. Kermanos, and Twitter feed is going crazy right now over
Quebec City. Club isn't moving, if that's your question.
That was exactly my question. Is there a message for the people from Quebec City over this situation?
On Carolina, there is no message. I know when Montreal was in for a game a few weeks ago, the Twitter sphere went nuts over the club is moving, and it was simply a made-up story. And I hope when I got asked the question by Pierre, my answer was clear. Peter may sell, he may not sell. He may sell all of it, he may sell some of it. He may sell none of it. There's no formal sale process going on. There's no imperative for the franchise to be sold on any immediate basis, and the franchise is not moving. I hope that was definitive enough.
Next All-Star game, you haven't announced one yet.
No, we haven't.
Obviously tied to an Olympic decision.
Well, if we're not participating in the Olympics and we're not taking a break, we'll have an All-Star game.
Have you decided where that would be?
We've looked at a few places, and we're looking at a few places, but we haven't made a decision yet.
Okay.
Anybody else?
Gary, can I just follow up on the All-Star thing? Was there a contract with Bill Foley that within 5-6 years, whatever, that he will, as part of his agreement, get an All-Star game down the road?
I believe, Bill, correct me if I'm wrong on this. We think it would be a good idea to have an All-Star game at some point in Las Vegas. I'm certain we didn't commit on a date, but I think our intention is at some point in the earlier days of the franchise, as opposed to 20 or 30 years down the road, think we could have fun in Las Vegas with an All-Star game. Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Yes. We've expressed a mutual intention that it would be a good idea. Listen, they got 6,000 people to come out to hear the announcement of the name. That's pretty good fan support. And like many other places, it's an interesting and fun destination to go to for the weekend. Anybody else? Great. It's good to see all of you. Please enjoy the events of the weekend. It's great to be here, and it's great to have all of you here. Thank you.